of practice is the great vehicle wisdom, and that's what we are supposed trying to attain. And the initial verse, as soon as the Buddha realized and entered the truthful universe, which is firstly refers to the part that Master explained about attaining the enlightenment and gazing at the sun. We'll come to that later. This natural wisdom resonated with the essence of true suchness. So this natural wisdom that he already had, and obviously when he cleared all the past, or rather, go back and use like the same word, when he has extinguished all his affliction and clear all this karmic seeds, and that's when the natural wisdom resonate with the true suchness. So that is the Buddha of wisdom. And with the vastness of time and space, he awakened the ocean of wisdom. Obviously, then he attained the whole universe of wisdom and under the whole truth. And he opened and revealed the world to his realization of the truth. So as I listened to, or rather read through the whole transcript, I realized that I think, I mean, from my mind, I think it refers a lot to the Bodhisattva vows, of course, because this is the great vehicle. And I'll try to relate to the vows of practice. And this is explain the journey of the vows. So in Master's explanation, the truthful universe is realized in stillness, which is just a very natural state. So what do you mean by a very natural state and this natural wisdom? It's the, you see, I think in the worldly life, we all cluttered in the way how we should live our life. And it's all defined by worldly conventions. So, and who defined the worldly conventions? Worldly conventions are defined by worldly people with their worldly minds and how we should behave, how we should be educated, so on and so forth. So therefore, when that happens, that natural state is being buried. So to realize that, we need to be in stillness so that we are no longer influenced by the noises of the world. And that's when your natural wisdom will be able to surface. So when the Buddha attained enlightenment, it naturally occurred in an instant. And that instant of enlightenment, and that's when the instant of encompassing the vastness of time and space, where he could understand everything. And this time and space are very expansive, very large, encompasses the whole space. So imagine the spaces of the whole universe. But while this time is very long and our minds are actually filled with so many discursive thoughts, and this is supposed to be a spiritual journey for us, it's one of immeasurable distance and a big long time. All this time, we have a lot of discursive thoughts within us. And this is the reason why we need to be in the state of stillness so that we are not influenced negatively by all these thoughts by applying the four right efforts. So because we have so many discursive thoughts, our pure and awakened interesting nature hasn't been contaminated by them, which is the point that I was trying to say, that because of the noises of the world, we all get buried within that. So that wisdom or the, and that true suchness unable to surface. So the Buddha manifests in this world to help us understand that spiritual practice is meant to help us to return from our discursive thinking to our pure intrinsic nature. So the Buddha took on life as a human being in this world, so which are very fortunate. And therefore, shown us that can be attained and showed us in his through his life how that can be done. So in the Buddha's spiritual journey, he went through 96 kinds of religious teachings, and obviously he went through all of them and found that they are different practices. So he learned from all these different practices, and some of them, most of them, I mean, obviously all of them did not get him to what he wanted to attain. So, and he did this for 5 years to learn all these 96 methods. And then he went on to 6 years of ecstatic practice altogether. It took 11 years to do that. So obviously, I mean, from the context, compared to for ourselves, that 11 years actually is not a long period of time. It's quite short. And I mean, when I read about this, I reflect upon myself and minus the early years in which obviously I do have spiritual experiences, just that I did not take them seriously and I didn't have time for them. So because of my way of life being defined by the worldly conventions, that I have to do my studies and things like that. So until I graduated and have time to get engaged in spirituality. But even that for me, it took me 30 years to really take on a serious path. So when I reflect upon that, obviously for the Buddha is one who is highly cultivated, and for 11 years for him to reach that state is indeed very, very fast. So when his mind's eye connected with the star, when he attained enlightenment, so in that instance, suddenly an entire universe unfolded within his mind. So actually, when the Buddha attained enlightenment, after Buddha attained enlightenment, and after gazing to the star and the morning came, he spent actually the first week gazing at a Bodhi tree in which he attained enlightenment. And altogether, he spent 7 weeks in the place and different levels of experiences in that within that 7 weeks. And so this is to show his gratitude to all the condition that enable him to attain enlightenment. And so for us, the Buddha has shown us that even in him taking the human body, they could attain it.
Breakfast, huh?
So in the wisdom in the Dharma, and to seek the Buddha's wisdom, those with all the wisdom of the Dharma can realize ultimate reality of phenomena. Okay, to seek the Buddha wisdom, it's not enough to simply understand, to rely on external phenomena like as existing condition. We must seek the wisdom of all Dharma. So if you look at it, seek the wisdom of all Dharma, that's what does it relate to? Now, in the first Bodhisattva vow is to liberate or deliver all sentient beings, right? So you all understand that very clearly. And the second Bodhisattva vow that Master has been explaining to us time and time again is to uproot all evil passions. So to seek the wisdom of Dharma, and this is what this chapter is about, and this is about your third Bodhisattva vow, is to enter all the Dharma doors. So we must seek the entirety of the Buddha's wisdom, and this third vow is really about understanding and discerning and practicing all the types of Dharma, the seek the wisdom of Dharma, and realize the ultimate reality of phenomena. So it is a lot that we need to realize, and the Buddha did that to understand the whole universe. So seeking the ultimate reality is inseparable from realizing the nature of our phenomena. So therefore, all the phenomena that we observe in our life, so that's the reason why every moment is a practice. I will share with you on on my contemplation about even a dew, which I've mentioned to you all before, even a dew, you can learn from a small little dew in the morning. So ultimate reality is in all phenomena, but we ordinary people cannot comprehend all the appearances are inseparable from underlying principles. And whatever we see, be it in name, be it forms, whatever the case may be, there's always a learning. So, I mean, sometimes different things happen to us at different times in different ways. And sometimes the storms in our life that happen to us, they're not there to make our life difficult, but it is there to clear our path, our own afflictions. And so we just need to learn to understand the Dharma, to know how to apply to that. So in this great vehicle teaching, Master explaining that the four requisites, which is the teachings, right? So you're going to learn from those teachings, the principles, understand what are the principles of the teachings, get into practice and realization of all phenomena. So that is the part that you attain the great wisdom of enlightenment. So this wisdom obviously would take us a journey of immeasurable distance, and we've got many, many more lifetimes to go. So if we want to understand principles, you must first hear them, which is the listening, right? And then and put them into practice, then we realize the fruits. So this realization of the fruits is that of the great vehicle teaching. And that is the third vow, the Dharma dons, and then to attain the supreme enlightenment, which is the fourth vow that you have undertaken in the four bodies of the vows. So after listening, in order to truly unite with the principles, must put them in practice to experience them. We need to experience them. You see, experiencing the teachings helps you to retain the teachings. If you study the teaching, you listen, you and you try to retain it, it's through your mind. So experiencing it is to make it as a part of your nature, that you are actually part of the teaching. So therefore, when you walk, when you live the exemplary life of a spiritual aspirant, you are actually a walking Dharma to inspire others to the path. And that is what we are trying to do in a Bodhisattva path. And this is what Master is trying to get us engaged, is Dharma in activities and to inspire others. So the lessons learned in here is when Bodhisattvas begin their practice, they form the great aspiration, the aspiration to attain the supreme enlightenment, right? Through the four Bodhisattva vows. By constantly cultivating the four infinite minds, they go from being the three vehicle practitioners to the state of Buddhahood. So obviously, even for us in a great vehicle, we also need to understand the teaching of the Four Noble Truths of the small vehicle. We need to understand the 12 links of causation or 12 links of cyclic existence of the middle vehicle and the six parameters. So these four Bodhisattva vows, which is in your great aspiration, which is your internal cultivation, and then your four infinite minds is for external cultivation in your practice. So they cultivate everything simultaneously. And obviously we have to do both in our cultivation, whether internal or external. So we go from the ship card, the air card, and the card of the pool by the great white ox. Three kinds of wisdom, and then you be united as one. So this equally possess Dharma nature is not to be sought outside of yourself. So we do not need to seek the answers outside ourselves. It is inherently within us. And this is what the Buddha nature is, that which all we need to do is to engage in the diligent practice. So in the environment in which we live in the world that we are living right now, although there are worldly ways and worldly conventions, there are all teachings for all of us. So the becomings that of our life that come to us is for us to learn and a unique karmic footprint for us to travel. So, and to do so, we eliminate our afflictions, right? And whether it's the second body sort of vow, right? Eliminate our afflictions and strengthen our spiritual aspiration, realize our Buddha nature, which is our fourth body sort of vows. So, in contemplation, there are infinite lessons learned from nature, which is resonates to today's teaching that we learn from all phenomena. And this particular line alone I've shared with you all before, but let me explain this a little bit. Vastness is the wisdom, yet each deal is filled with wisdom. You see, wisdom is very, very vast. It's vast as the universe. But for us who live in this world, being an unenlightened being, let's look at this particular world that we have. So if a drop of dew, a small droplet of a dew, You look at it and you magnify that, you know that you can reflect the whole world. And I just, this is a realization that came to me in one of my trip, on one of my pilgrimage trip. And it was very early morning that I wandered off, and it was around dawn, and I wanted to watch the sunrise. I was high up in a mountain. This was in, if I remember, this was in the boat of Samanabhadra in China. And I was walking by, and it was very thick with morning dew. And that's when I realized that when I took a picture of the dew, it was, and I magnified that dew and was quite amazed at what I could see from the dew. And that's why it made me realize that even that small dew is filled with wisdom. And therefore, we need to respect nature, because when you respect nature, nature will teach you. So on relationship about harmony, I shared with you one of my realization about the hollow part of a flute, how music melodies. This is from a different perspective and about harmony. So in the harmony of life, life is a song for you to compose. The lyrics are in the Dharma. The music is in your practice. So do not leave sour notes behind. Live life in practice in the flow of harmony. Like a chanted priest of virtues and wisdom, be in the flow of the whisper, in the wind caressing through the melodies of your life. Okay, Gan En, brothers and sisters, that's all I have.
We are drowned by the
point. Flow in the harmony of life.
Your respect, brother Jin.
醉了，醉了，醉了，you know, yeah. No.